Hello, this is the Science Communicator, and today I have a huge pleasure to talk with Professor Anne Lullier, a French physicist and professor of atomic physics at Lund University in Sweden. Professor Lullier was on the Nobel Prize Committee for Physics between 2007 and 2015, and she has been a member of the Swedish Academy of Sciences since 2004. In 2022, she received the Wolf Prize in Physics for pioneering contributions to ultrafast laser science and attosecond physics. Of course, these are the things we're going to talk about in just a moment, and I think I can lift the veil of secrecy already and say the things we're going to talk about are truly amazing, fascinating, even mind-boggling, if I can use this expression, for average lay people. So I'm really excited. But of course, first of all, I would like to say hello, Professor. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Hello. Nice to be with you.
You specialize in attosecond physics. So first of all, I think I should ask you to explain to me, what is an attosecond? It's a really tiny fraction of a second, very, very hard to imagine.
It's very, very small time interval. It's 10 to minus 18 second. This is one attosecond. And I mean, one way to try to explain what it is to say that there is as much from 1 second to the age of the universe than from what the second to the attosecond. So it's a very, very short time interval.
Yes, and your research deals with the so-called attosecond light pulses, bursts of light. First of all, I would like to know, for what purposes is such radiation used?
Well, this radiation is used to a little bit like flashes of a camera. The idea is to try to look at very fast processes, and these processes happen in the microcosmos, in atoms and molecules. And especially this attosecond time scale is the time scale of motion of electrons. So that's a little bit the goal, or this is to try to follow the motion of electrons in matter.
In what way do attosecond light pulses help study the movements of electrons?
You can see them as so we're looking at photo-induced processes. So processes which are triggered by absorption of light. So this is the idea. And these processes have been studied in the past with lamps, with synchrotron radiation, with X-rays. But in one way, and with attosecond pulses, we provide a different way to look at these processes, and the goal is really to learn new things. So what we used to say as well is that so when you light is absorbed by a molecule, or then there is the first thing that happens is that the electron move. And then in the end, and then this trigger other motion of nuclei, and maybe this is how starts chemical reaction. So the idea is to study that and to maybe control in the end this chemical reaction. But this is very basic science, fundamental science. So there is no direct application yet. We are trying to study new things, but it's really the beginning.
Attosecond physics is quite a young discipline, or am I wrong?
Yeah, it depends what you call young. I think different discoveries have different time scales. I think the field started in the end of the 80s with the discovery of this high order harmonic generation. But then the first attosecond pulses were shown, were really, it was demonstrated in the laboratory 2001. And then there, I would say that the applications start to develop maybe 2010. So in that sense, it's, I would say, relatively new field. And what is happening now is that the field is going into different directions, into atomic molecular physics, chemistry, into condensed matter, into other applications, so maybe towards the industry. So it's a little bit going into several directions at the moment. But you can say that the field is old because it's more than 30 years old, but maybe it's the idea that now we can start to use this radiation in a useful way. Maybe this is a little bit younger.
And now I would like to again try to imagine, how is it possible to generate such ultra-fast, short attosecond light pulses?
It's actually quite easy. You simply use an intense laser, femtosecond. You focus this laser into a gas, and the gas of atoms, and we use noble gases like argon, xenon, neon, and then in the same direction and following the laser, you have the emission of high order harmonics of the laser field, and this high order harmonics in the time domain consists of a train of attosecond pulses, so very short light pulse. Now, if you want to have only one attosecond pulse, then you need to start with a very short laser pulse to begin with, and then you can have, if the conditions are right, a single attosecond pulse. But in Lund, we usually work with the attosecond pulse train, this series of attosecond pulses.
In 1987, as far as I know, you were involved in a very important experiment in France. Could you tell me a few words about this experiment?
Yes, this and this experiment really affected my career. It's really this is after this experiment that I decided to do research in this field. So what happened in 87? We were looking at the interaction of atoms in strong laser field. This was the research of this small group in France, and I was a very young researcher at that time. And at some point we were looking at first before at the ions that were generated and the electrons, and then we decided we now want to look at the photons that are emitted and fluorescence light, so we focused our laser into a gas, and now we look at the radiation that is emitted, and we analyze this radiation with a grating, and in order to get enough photons, we start increasing the pressure of this gas jet, and suddenly we see not so much what we expected, which was fluorescence, so light from excited atoms. We saw instead light at frequency corresponding to high order harmonics of the laser field. So it's simply a multiple of the laser frequency. And it's not only a few orders, but many, many orders. And what was surprising is that these harmonics had the same intensity. We get the same signal for all of these harmonics up in this experiment, up to the 33rd harmonic, so this very high number. And the fact that all of these harmonics had the same intensity means that this was a strong response of the atoms to the laser field. And this was important. It was really at the beginning of a new research field, and also almost immediately, a few or maybe a couple of years afterwards, came the idea, oh, but if these harmonics would arrive at the same time, so would have we call it locked in phase, they will be synchronized, then in the time domain you would have a very short light pulse, attosecond light pulse, and very well-known scientists at the time really predicted, oh, but if they are synchronized, then we have these very short light pulses. And this was shown theoretically in 93 and also later, and it was shown then in the laboratory in 2001.
So I understand that was the breakthrough research for this field, for attosecond physics.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Well, breakthrough, I don't know. There are many breakthroughs actually in this field, but this was, I would say, the start.
The start, the beginning.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And why did you decide to work in Sweden at Lund University?
Yeah. what happened is that so after that experiment, I decided really to work on that. This was new. I was a young researcher, full of enthusiasm, so I worked on that, tried to understand and to describe theoretically. But then we were using different laser system, and around the at the beginning of the 90s, there was a change in laser technology, from the laser that we were using to the laser based on titanium sapphire, and together with the chirp pulse amplification, which is the new, which is an invention that actually got Nobel Prize in 2018 to Donna Strickland and Gerard Nourou. So a combination of this new laser medium, titanium sapphire, and the chirp pulse amplification, suddenly you had perfect laser for this high order harmonic generation with a high repetition rate at that time of 10 hertz. So in 92, I was invited by Professor Sune Svanberg to come to the inauguration of a new laser laboratory with this technology. And maybe I could come with our experimental setup and do experiments with the new laser. This is what I did. I took actually my first PhD student together with me, and then the second PhD student came along, and we did experiment. And what happened during that time is that I also met my future husband. So a couple of years afterwards, I decided to move in Sweden permanently. And after that, I got a position. But this is the reason why I moved to Sweden, really because of this new laser and this European collaboration. But then because, of course, I moved to Sweden because of I met my husband. Yeah.
So also personal reasons.
Yes.
You served on the Nobel Prize Committee for Physics for quite a few years. Was it in any way a challenge for you? Was this role difficult in any way?
This was really a challenge, and this is a very difficult role. We have a lot of responsibility to do it right, and so we feel a high pressure, I would like to say, to do a good job. And at the same time, it has to be completely confidential. This was a very interesting responsibility. I enjoyed it very much. I learned a lot of physics in many areas. But it was a Very interesting. I don't regret I have done that, but it was a very heavy. It was also a relief when my time was over. So fun, good, but this is an important job. I mean,
we would like.
I think the Nobel Prize is. It's a very nice prize. It's prestigious. It's very old, and somehow, as a member of the committee, we are only something like seven. Varies a little bit from year to year, and then we have this responsibility to do the right thing, to choose the right subject, the right person. And then we need to write the scientific background and around it, and it has to be right as well. So it is again very interesting, but a tough job, definitely a challenge, I would like to call it. But I enjoyed it very much. I think it was important for my career as a whole to do that.
And how did you become interested in physics, in science, in the first place? I'm always curious about that. I always ask my guests about their beginnings. How did it start for you? Did you have any role models, perhaps? Was there anyone who inspired you in a particular way?
I think I have always been interested by let's say physics and mathematics. Role model, of course Marie Curie is a role model for all young women. I would like to say women in general. Then I had a grandfather on my mother's side who was. Working in radio, electrical engineering, but he was pioneer of radio, and I don't really remember him. He died when I was five or something like that. But he was a professor doing research. You had the picture of his invention in the house where I was spending my vacation. So this said, and also he had been using this radio and communication during the Second World War. So this was a little bit also very impressive. So he was not participating with, you know, weapon or anything, but with science. So and helping out with science. So that was that impressed me as a young girl. And also the teaching part. He was professor. He was living in the countryside, but going to Paris a few times per week to teach. And this was also professor. Again, I have not seen that myself, but this is more family history.
Yes. Do you enjoy teaching students?
I enjoy teaching very much. And as I'm getting older, I gain a little bit confidence in my role as a teacher, and I enjoy it more and more. So this is part of my job. I feel teaching is an important part. It's not only teaching to courses. It's also telling about my research to other people. It's interacting with my PhD students. So this is a. I think an important part of this, even maybe more than research itself. I don't know.
Professor Lullier, thank you so much for talking with me, for accepting my invitation. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you very much.